Welcome, everybody. Welcome to Breath of Life Church. My name is Pastor Tony, and guess what? I'm in recovery. We're all in recovery. Last week, we began a series that for the next 7 more weeks, we're going to be doing a message, a teaching message on road to recovery. People don't realize it. There's freedom. I spoke about the fact that many people are in denial. They think that they're Christians, and all of a sudden, they are bound by some kind of habit, some kind of flaw in their walk, and they don't realize that they're bound. But today, we're going to break those freedoms. Maybe one of those things that are holding you back from really expressing Jesus is your hurts. The title of my message today is When We Give Help to Those That Are Hurting. Are you hurting right now? Is your marriage on the rocks? Is your children being disobedient? Are you physically disabled? Are you going through a channel with your health? Whatever the situation, you're tuning on to this message and you came to the right place. It's not about a whole bunch of do's and don'ts, but it's actually allowing Jesus Christ to come into our lives and say, Lord, I'm hurting today, and I don't understand why. So I just ask you, wherever you are watching me today, maybe at work, maybe in your living room, maybe at the grocery store, wherever it is, I just want you to bow your heart and pray with me and ask the Holy Spirit to give you an ear to hear what the Word has to say. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for an opportunity to speak to those that could not come today to Breath of Life Church, for whatever reason, Lord. And Lord, you've given us this gift of YouTube and Facebook and live streaming. We can get the message to the four corners of the world. And so, Lord, I ask the Holy Spirit to come and show his presence and touch those ears that need to hear. And they're hurting people out there today. And they're looking for answers. And they came to the right place. I pray that someone will get touched today. Amen. Last week, we've had a lot of rain here in Phoenix, but really up in the mountains, Flagstaff, and also by Superstition Mountains, if you're from Arizona, and the flooding was coming down. And there was one story of a man where the water was getting so high, he actually had to sit on top of his house. And just before the rains came, he promised his wife that he would mow the lawn. Now he's sitting on his house and the floodwaters are coming by. And the only thing that came by his mind was, I got to cut the grass. Meanwhile, objects are floating by, tree limbs and cars and refrigerators. They're all floating by. And he's thinking about cutting the grass. But meanwhile, there are more problems at stake. Maybe people are dying because of the flood. But he didn't see it that way. This week, talk about your hang-ups, your habits, all your hurting that you're going through that we don't have to hold on to no more. God wants to free us this morning. You see, everybody needs recovery. I need recovery. We all need recovery. And basically, there are times when we can't control things. Things are out of our control, and that's what hurts us because we want to be able to fix our problems, but we can't. And the more insecure we are, the more we want to control. Maybe your wife, maybe your husband, maybe your children, maybe your boss, maybe the pastor. You want to control things because you're insecure, because the hurt, maybe even something that happened long ago, is affecting the way you think and you respond rather than thinking about where is this coming from. You see, we want to be God where God is. But sometimes when we try to take control, what happens? We get fatigued. We get frustrated. We have hang-ups. We start doing things on our own instead of trusting in God. And sometimes it's hard to trust in God. Why? because the hurt is so deep and everybody has let you down. And to give God the trust is hard for some people. And the number one reason is trial. People are denying the fact that God is alive and he's doing well. Because that's the first step in recovery. If we can just get a mindset and say, you know what? I have a need right now. I'm hurting and I'm on this road to freedom. And the first thing I want to lay down is my denial. I have to admit to God that I'm hurting. Because you tried it your way and it doesn't work. So, how you doing this morning? You got a problem this morning? Maybe you're going through a divorce, separation. Maybe you're in the hospital. Maybe you lost a child. Maybe somebody elderly with the pandemic, you lost them. And all these troubles are coming down and it's starting to affect your thinking. What makes me or you face up to our problems? What's it going to take to you to realize that you can't solve your problem? You see, God's remedy for those that have problems, that are in denial, is pain. Pain, pain, and more pain. You see, sometimes God allows pain to come rushing in. He doesn't orchestrate it, but he allows the enemy to come in and cause more pain. Why? It's because we're fighting God, trying to fix our problems when we can't. So we're in denial. So God says, okay, you want to do it your way? Go right ahead. So more pain comes in until a point where you say, I got to stop. Now, there are three denial busters, and I hope you pick this up. Number one, a crisis. A crisis is in your life, or tomorrow there'll be one, or you just got out of one. What are they? Illness, the pandemic, cancer, whatever it may be, in the hospital, valley fever, stress from your job, your marriage, your children, love. Maybe you don't feel loved no more. Maybe you're single and you've been looking for a spouse and you can't, and you're hurting, so you make wrong decisions. How about you just lost your job? Right now, out there, but not the one you're looking for. And meanwhile, the bills are starting to pile up. The second thing is confrontation. You're about to lose your family. Your wife is going to walk out on you. Why? Because you haven't been a good husband. And you didn't want to change because you're in denial. And because you're in denial, you're watching something just float right on by. Maybe it's your health. Maybe you're ready to take your last breath of fresh air. And you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Today is going to be the day that you accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe a fire alarm. Has anybody got a fire alarm in their house? I know I have. And when that fire alarm goes off, it's because something is happening in your home or an apartment. So what do most men do when the fire alarm goes off? They go up, get a ladder or a chair, they go up and they pull the battery out. It doesn't solve the problem. The fire alarm went off for a reason. There's danger in your home or your apartment, and all we did was try to fix the problem, but the problem is still there. You can't solve your problems by taking the battery out. It's about turning your life to Christ. We still have the pain. We still have the failure. And instead of just dealing with the source, we try to cover it up. And you come to church, and they ask you, hey, how's everything going? I missed you last week. And you say, everything's okay. I'm fine. And so what happens? We end up wearing a mask because we don't want people to see what's in our, really in our hearts. It's called denial. We're hurting, and we don't want people to know that we're hurting. We want people to think that we're doing okay. So how do we cover it up? Well, there are a couple of ways. Food. People, when they're hurting, will eat. and eat and eat, and they don't exercise, and they start to gain weight, and maybe you end up with diabetes. Maybe you end up with heart problems. How about alcohol? Substance abuse. Some people, when the pain is so great, they've just gone through a divorce or separation, and they turn to the bottle, or they turn to drugs. Or how about pornography? Men go out there, and they go to these strip clubs, and they watch all these nudies out there. Why? Because the pain of not having a happy home, you have to alleviate the pain by going to these places. So you pull out the battery. You don't solve your problem. You cover it up. And meanwhile, you're getting more sin into your life. You see, God will use these situations, not because he's punishing us, but to draw you back closer to him. He'll cause catastrophe. The bottom of your life will fall out physically, emotionally, spiritually, financially, and relationally. Everything will just start to fall apart. So what happens? Until we feel the full impact of our denial and our own stupid decisions, you want to say, God, I'm okay, when you're really not okay, but you're in denial and the hurt is so great. God says, okay, you are going to reap what you just sown. And when the full impact of the situations that are falling apart that causes a catastrophe in your life, you won't change. Last week, it was the first step toward the road to recovery. We have to realize we're not God. I'm not God. I can't fix your problems. You can't fix your problems. We have to admit we are powerless. So whatever you're going through tonight or this morning, guess what? Only God can get us through it. No matter what you try to do, you can't get rid of it. You have to start trusting God. We don't have control. And our tendency is always to do the wrong thing because our life is so unmanageable. But you may be watching me this morning and say, hey, Pastor, I got everything under control. Great. You're in denial because there is something wrong. Because you're trusting yourself as God instead of trusting the God. Now, the second step on the road to recovery is today. We have to earnestly believe that God exists. Now in the world today, 98% of the people you speak to believe there's a God. But they believe in God up here, but there's no change down here. You ask people, how come you don't go to church? Well, I'm a self-made man. I'm okay. I just pray by myself. Well, that's not the church. The church was meant to come together. Why? We need each other. When somebody's hurting, we pray for somebody. If someone's in the hospital, we go visit that person. That's what the church is. So if you're sitting home watching and you used to be a member of this church, it's time to come home because you're sitting there hurting and maybe it's time to say, you know what? Maybe I'll give it another shot. Maybe somebody in the church hurt me, but I'm going to ask God to help me to forgive that person. So we have to acknowledge that God's existence. Most of us may say, I have no problems. Romans 1:20 says this, since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities and his external power and his divine nature is clearly seen. Meaning this, we look at the world today and we see everywhere the power of God. God is everywhere. God is in everything. And that's the glory that we have, that we know that God's in control and not us. In Psalms 19, it says this, the heavens declare the glory of God. Now, people that come up to us and say, well, you're a Christian. It's foolish. Yeah, that's true. It's foolishness to those that don't believe. But to those that do believe, we know there is a higher power. And God today wants to help you with your hurts. He wants to help you with your pain. He doesn't want to just remove it. He wants to get you through it. You're sitting here right now watching me and say, I don't have an answer, Pastor. I'm listening to this message. I pray to God, but still, I don't have any results. It's okay. God's still sitting on the throne, and he's in control. You may say, well, what's up? When's he going to do it? There was a story about two Catholic boys. They were in Catholic school. I know, because I used to be in one many years ago. And they got called into the Mother Superior's office because they were a little rambunctious in class. So the teacher sent them to see Mother Superior. And the first boy goes into her office. And the Mother Superior tells the little boy, you know that God is real, God is existing. And after a long dissertation, she asked the boy, where is God? The boy didn't answer. Three or four times she said it again, where is God? And still, no answer. So, okay, I had enough of you. Go out there and get the other boy to come in. So as the boy is walking out, the second boy goes, what did she say? And the first boy said to her, I don't know. But it seems that they can't find God, and they're trying to blame you and me for his disappearance. You see, people want to believe there is no God because their situation is so unreal. Their hurts and pains are driving them to all these different ways of trying to alleviate the pain, but it's still there. Drugs, sex, rock and roll, whatever you try to do, going out there partying, going out there shopping, doesn't alleviate the problem. All you did was take out the battery from the alarm. Next, we have to understand his character. You see, if you don't know God's character, you're never going to trust God to say, God, I don't understand why I'm hurting, but I'm going to trust you. Because the Bible says you're the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And if you help me in the past of all my problems, you're going to help me get through this. Because I remember what you did back then. I didn't even deserve it. But you touched my life. You touched my marriage. You touched my body. You touched my finances. You got me through a storm that I never thought I'd get through. That's his character. And once you start to understand his character, you start to believe. What's he really like, you may be saying? Maybe you're tuning in for the very first time. Maybe you're confused by all these different religions that are out there. And you're saying, what's God really like? I've never seen God, but God is visible. When Jesus came down, he was the evidence of the invisible God because Jesus came down as God in the flesh so we can see the character of God. And what did he do while he was here? He healed people. He raised people from the dead. He fed 5,000 people out of a couple of loaves of bread and fish. That's the character of God. He cares. The Bible says when his friend died, Lazarus, he wept. He's concerned about you. And you may be hurting right now. And there's no way out of your problems. And this is going to be your invitation at the end of this message to say, Pastor, I'm hurting so bad, and I don't know what to do. You see, God knows your situation right now. He knows your habits, he knows your hurts, and he knows your hang-ups. Maybe you had a tough week. Maybe you had a tough month. Maybe you're having a tough moment right now, and you're on the brink of losing it. Jesus is saying, son, daughter, I'm right there. All you have to call her is one name, Jesus. You don't have to call in anybody else except Jesus. Psalm 31 says this, you've seen the crises that's in my soul. God is aware of your needs. He knows exactly where you're at. And if you're on the brink of making bad decisions, he's saying, son, daughter, just call on my name and I'll meet you right where you are. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. But you have to have Jesus in your corner. At the end, we're going to talk about how that can happen by praying and believing and saying, Lord, I'm a sinner. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I confess my sins. And when you do that, something supernatural happens. The Bible says he removes all of your sin and writes your name in the book of life. Oh, hallelujah. What a great day. And nobody can ever take that away. Hallelujah. God cares. Not only does he know your situation, he cares about your situation. Psalms 103 says this, he's like a father to us, tender, sympathetic, for he knows that we were made of dust. I know, maybe you're sitting there like I did many years ago and say, I never had a father who cared for me. All he did was put a belt to my back, a strap. Maybe he was in prison. Maybe he left your mother when you were a baby. And you don't have a good idea or a relationship of what a good dad is. And now you're hearing the scripture that he cares. You have a hard time relating to that. And the hurt is so deep because you wanted a dad when you were a little boy. You wanted to play baseball or soccer with him, but he wasn't there. And now that you're grown up, you're saying, why should I trust God? He wasn't there when I needed him. But he was. He's allowed the pain to come to a point where you raise your hands and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I didn't realize your character, that you do care about me. Would you come into my life? God loves us. He'll never quit on you. You may quit on him. You may go back into your habits and your hang-ups and your hurts. But guess what? He's always there waiting, saying, son, daughter, I can't stop you. I've given you that free will. It's your choice. And because his love is unconditional, it's not based on your do's and don'ts. You can't outgive God. You can't out-help God in the church. You just have to believe and receive, and that's how we get to heaven. The Bible says he not only knows about our situation, but he cares about it. Next, God can change your situation. You all know my story. I was a drug addict, got divorced. Everything collapsed in me. I was in the pits. I was hurting so bad, rejected by everybody. And I got on my motorcycle one day in the hills of Pennsylvania, and I cry out, if there is a God, show me, because I'm too chicken to go off this mountain. God met me right where I was, broken, hurting, rejected, abandoned, left alone, broke. I had nothing to give God, but yet he opened up his arms and received me just the way I was. You say, maybe God doesn't understand my situation. Maybe my situation is different from yours, Pastor. No, it's not. It's the same. You're hurting just like I was hurting. And lastly, he accepts us and he wants to help us today. You may be on the brink of doing something silly. Maybe just throwing in the towel like I almost did. But God says, I'm here for you. It's not enough just to believe in God. Most of us believe in God, but that hasn't wiped away your hurt, has it? You believe in God, but yet you're still hurting. Everything is collapsing on you, and you're hurting, but yet you believe in God. And so what does denial do? The first phase of road to recovery. Denial says, I'm okay. Why? You don't want to admit to people that you're hurting. You want to be so self-sufficient because we think we're gods, and we're not. We're just flesh and blood, and one day we're going to be buried and turned back into dust. So Philippians 2:13 says this, "For God is at work within you, giving us the will and the power to achieve his purpose." Maybe you're sitting there watching me and saying, "My life's a mess. Everything I tried to do has failed. Business, jobs, relationships, marriage, children, everything wiped out." But God says, no. He's giving us the will and the power to succeed if you just give him a chance. Willpower on your own is not enough. There is no such thing as a self-made man. Doesn't work. That's pride. It's denial. God's intentions are not enough. Your willpower is not enough. You say, "God, I'm willing, but my flesh is weak." What happens when we open up our life to God? What does he do? "Pastor, you mean to tell me if I give my life to Jesus Christ right now, something is going to happen?" Yes. The joy of the Lord is going to flood your soul. You may still have the pain of the problems you're facing, but the joy in your heart, knowing that Jesus now is in control of your hurts and your pains and your shortcomings, and it's no longer you. And you become more loving. You see, when you get plugged in, when you get plugged into God, it's like a shaver. It's like a toaster. It's like a vacuum cleaner. They all work with cords in them. And you got to plug it in order for it to work. Because if not, nothing works. Well, the same way with Jesus Christ. If you're not plugged into Jesus Christ, just knowing God doesn't change your situation. You got to plug in. And that's why I want to invite you back into Breath of Life Church. Why? Because we're teaching our people how to plug in. That when the alarm goes off, we just don't pull the battery and say everything is okay. No, we deal with the situation and say, "Father, I believe and I trust in you, and I'm giving all my cares over to you." And something happens. Maybe your situation doesn't change, but something inside changes. And that's what makes the difference. Because Jesus said, "My children are going to suffer for my sake, but it's temporary compared to eternally spending life in heaven." God says, "I need you." And the road to recovery is not easy. That means you're going to face some real problems. But you got to be honest with him. You can't try to hide it. He knows what you're doing, even in your darkest corner. He knows what you're doing. So I end this message this way. Are you hurting right now? Are you going through some deep waters? Are you plugged into Jesus Christ? Not just with head knowledge, but are you plugged in here? Do you feel like you're going under for the last time? See, "Pastor, if I don't get any help right now, I'm going down." Are you going through the fire right now where the heat is all around you? Wife ready to walk out on you? Your husband's cheating on you? Your children are rebelling against you? They're getting involved in drugs and alcohol, maybe even gangs? And you're out of control in your home. It's chaos in your home. There's no peace. You don't sit at the table and offer up a prayer of sacrifice. Say, "Thank you, Lord, for blessing me with this food." There's no joy no more. Everybody's got their phones out. Everybody's got their television out. Everybody's got their computers out. But nobody's not plugged into Jesus. You see, you can't get the power if you don't change. You got to plug it in. So the question is, do you feel powerless today? There's a higher power that you can plug into, and his name is Jesus. I'd like to invite you to open up your heart right now, right where you are. If you're sitting down on the couch, I want you to stand, or you can kneel right there in front of your computer or television. If you're on the job and you got a lunch hour break, I want you to just stop what you're doing and just bow your head. And we're going to give our lives to Jesus Christ. And then we're going to pray that he just doesn't take the hurt away. He gets you through the hurt and through the pains, because I said, I'm with you forever. Father, I thank you, Lord. I believe you're going to reach hurting people this evening. This is the second stop on our road to recovery. Oh, what a joy it is that you're going to start peeling back areas in our life that we've covered up from the past. Maybe something happened many, many years ago. Maybe somebody was raped. Maybe somebody was molested. Maybe somebody was beaten by their father. Maybe somebody was divorced early in their life. Maybe somebody's gone through a trauma that they've hid all their lives and no one knew about it. And they've carried that into adulthood. And that's why there's no joy in their life. There's no peace in their life. There's no victory in their life because they try to muster it up with their fake face and it doesn't work. I believe you're going to break through with this message, Lord, and you're going to touch somebody today. So I want you to repeat after me. Say, Jesus, come into my life. I believe and I receive you as my Lord and Savior, that one day, not because of all my mistakes, because you know I've made many, because I believe that you died and rose from the dead. And you said that those who believe in me will not suffer, but they will be with me for eternity. Hallelujah. If you did that prayer this right now, I want you to pick up the phone. Call the number of Breath of Life Church here in South Phoenix. Call me up, and I'll pray with you. If you need a Bible, I'll get one to you. God bless you. Turn in next week as we go to part 3 on the road to recovery. Thank you, and God bless you. Thank you so much for joining us this morning and watching us on live stream. We'd like for you to partner with us with your tithes and offering and subscribe to us on YouTube and Facebook for future events. If you have a need right now, maybe someone's sick, maybe somebody in the hospital. Right now, we have somebody standing by on the computer and the phones that'll take your prayer request. If somebody got saved today on the message, we'll send you a Bible. Give us a call and be blessed. Thank you so much. Hope to see you again next Sunday. God bless.